Welcome to the cardiovascular system, the vasculature, part 1. This tutorial will cover the basics of blood vessels and then focus on arteries. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, and I'm the histology wizard. Let's start with some basics.
Arteries function to transport blood away from the heart under high pressure, and they store some of the pumped blood during each cardiac systole to ensure continued flow through the capillaries during diastole. There are three categories of arteries. Large-sized elastic arteries that conduct blood from the heart to body tissues and organs, medium-sized muscular arteries that distribute blood to organs, to smaller arteries and arterioles that function as resistance vessels, controlling the blood flow into capillary beds. Capillaries function as exchange vessels, while veins are conduits for transport of blood from the tissues back to the heart. To review, arteries regulate pressure and control distribution. Capillaries and post-exchange venules are exchangers, and these vessels only hold about 5 to 10% of the blood at any given time, but the veins hold nearly 70%. Similar to the heart, the walls of large vessels need their own blood supply, and this happens through vasovasorum. Now, there are variations in blood pressure in different parts of the circulatory system, and each vessel has specific and different functions. Thus, the structures and organizations of each type of vessel are dictated by these different functional demands, just as in the heart.
First, we'll briefly review some basic features of vessels and then move on to the histology and functions of arteries. We'll start by looking at a simple cartoon that illustrates the basics of the layers.
Most of the large vessels are three-layered, but those vessels that function as exchangers, such as capillaries and early venules, have only one layer. First, we have the outer and inner layers. These allow heart and vessels to interact with the body and the blood. And as the blood pressure changes, vessels need to be able to regulate their size to accommodate blood pressure changes and varying metabolic needs of tissues, and they can do this by way of the middle layer. Again, exchangers such as capillaries and small venules have only one wall, while lymphatic capillaries lack a well-defined layer structure. Now, like the heart, blood vessel walls consist of three tunics or layers. First, the innermost layer is called the tunica intima. It consists of an endothelial lining which is continuous with the endocardium of the heart. Similar to the endocardium, the tunica intima has a subendothelium comprised of connective tissue, and it sometimes contains a layer of elastic fibers called the internal elastic lamina. The middle layer, the tunica media, is the thickest and consists mainly of smooth muscle cells with collagen fibers, elastic sheaths, and extracellular matrix. The collagen fibers provide structural support and limit the distensibility of the vessel. The tunica adventitia is the outermost layer, and it consists mostly of connective tissue. Now, depending on the vessel, an external elastic lamina is present that separates tunica media from tunica adventitia. As noted previously, the tunica adventitia of larger vessels can contain vasovasorum analogous to the epicardium. So let's take a look at the histology. Here we see a muscular artery containing the tunica intima, showing an endothelial cell nucleus here, and the internal elastic lamina. In the tunica media, you can appreciate the layers of smooth muscle cells with their characteristic nuclei. This artery also has an external elastic lamina separating the tunica media from the tunica adventitia. Note the difference in staining between the connective tissue of the tunica adventitia and the smooth muscle layer of the tunica media. Now we'll take a closer look at the characteristics of each type of vessel. We'll start with the different types of arteries, beginning with the large elastic arteries. This includes the aorta, the common carotid, and common iliac arteries. Now remember, these are considered conducting arteries because they transport blood from the heart to the medium-sized distributing arteries. Large elastic arteries have two major characteristics. They receive blood from the heart under high pressure, and they keep blood circulating continuously even though the heart pumps intermittently. Thus, these arteries have histological features that allow them to do these jobs. In this first image, which is an H&E stained section of the aorta, you can appreciate the large tunica media. This Verhoff stained section highlights the large amount of elastic fibers found in the tunica media, which allows these arteries to distend during systole and retract during diastole, and to sustain a continuous blood flow, no matter the pressure coming from the heart. Collagen fibers are enriched in the tunica adventitia, which again can contain lymphatics, nerves, and vasovasorum. There is a gradual transition from the large arteries to medium-sized arteries to small arteries and arterioles. So next, let's take a look at the muscular arteries, those medium-sized arteries that are termed distributing vessels. These allow blood to be selectively distributed to different organs in response to varying functional needs. Examples include the radial, tibial, and intercostal arteries. The tunica intima in muscular arteries contains the endothelium, subendothelium, and internal elastic lamina. As shown in this Azen stain, there are many, many layers of smooth muscle. Although there are elastic fibers, these are not as abundant, and they decrease as the size of the artery decreases. These arteries are less concerned with smoothing out blood pressure. The large muscular arteries, such as the one seen here, also have a prominent external elastic lamina and lots of collagen to provide support, collagen which is staining blue in this Azen stained section. Now here's a comparison of elastic versus muscular arteries. We won't go over this, but you should be able to recognize the differences and distinguish between the two types. We'll next look at small arteries and arterioles. Arterioles are the final branches of the arterial system. These vessels regulate the distribution of blood to different capillary beds by vasoconstriction and vasodilation. Arterioles are specifically adapted for this role because their smooth muscle fibers are arranged in circles. They're considered resistance vessels and typically have small lumens, which allows them to close down to generate high resistance to blood flow. Thus, they are the major determinants of blood pressure. These vessels have the same three tunics as the larger arteries, and small arteries differ from arterioles primarily in the number of concentric smooth muscle fiber layers. Arterioles have only 1 to 2 layers, while a small artery may have 5 to 6. Arterioles connect directly to capillaries in many tissues, but in some tissues, arterioles are part of the microvascular circulation. The microvascular bed consists of terminal arterioles with their layers of smooth muscle fibers. The metarteriole, which is the very terminal branch of the arterial system and an important regulator of blood flow. The capillary bed, or true capillaries, and postcapillary venules. Flow through true capillaries is controlled by the precapillary sphincters of metarterioles. These sphincters are bands of smooth muscle that open and close on around 5-second cycles to control blood entry into capillary beds. Normally, these sphincters are partially closed due to the muscle tone of the smooth muscle. These sphincters respond to signals by constricting and dilating, thus modulating the blood flow. So let's go ahead and examine two different scenarios. First, let's consider the situation when sphincters are relaxed. This results in blood flowing through the capillary bed. Second, we see a case where the sphincters contract in response to perhaps norepinephrine release from sympathetic nerve endings. This causes the channels to the capillary bed to constrict. Blood bypasses the bed and flows instead directly from the metarteriole through the thoroughfleur channel to the venule. This basic design varies from organ to organ, but in general, the setup allows exquisite local control of blood flow. Blood flow that can respond to local conditions of the tissues, such as concentrations of nutrients, blood gases, and metabolites. It allows for very rapid responses. However, lack of control of blood flow can have serious consequences. Let's think about it in the same way as rivers having dams. Dams that allow for control of water flow into various regions or side channels. Here we have the Red River, which might have a number of smaller dams, seen here in red, that provide local control of water flow. Loss of those dams, or loss of control of the dams, can result in too much water flowing into those local channels, and this can result in flooding. Similarly, if the sphincters are compromised or too much blood is flowing into the capillary bed, this results in high capillary pressure, and fluid will pass out of the capillary into the interstitial space. If the lymphatic system cannot accommodate the fluid, edema can result. Now, you should be able to predict what would happen to the sphincters in response to different local or systemic conditions. For example, will the precapillary sphincters open or close in a capillary bed that is high in oxygen? If you answered close, you are correct. If the O2 levels in those tissue cells are already high, no more blood flow is needed in that area until oxygen levels are lower again. Now go ahead and try to answer this one on your own. There are a number of alternative microvascular pathways. Arteriovenous shunts, or anastomoses, are direct connections between arterioles and postcapillary venules, and they bypass that microvascular bed. This is used by capillaries in the skin for thermoregulation. Portal systems which connect two capillary beds with a portal vein, are used in both the liver and pituitary gland, while an arterial portal system is used in the kidney. So in the kidney, an arteriole is interposed between two capillary networks. The afferent arteriole gives rise to a mass of capillaries, the glomerulus. Then these capillaries form an efferent arteriole, which gives rise to capillary networks surrounding the nephrons. We will look more closely at these alternatives when we study these systems later in the unit.
That's all for arteries. For more on the vasculature, check out my next tutorial on capillaries and veins. For more on the cardiovascular system, check out Cardiovascular Pathology. Thanks for stopping by.